Thank you. We are an academic program at Hunter. We offer a 12-credit minor in Asian American Studies. Asian American Studies, as you know, hopefully is an interdisciplinary field, which means that you can take courses cross-listed with urban studies, sociology, English, women and gender studies, hopefully in the future, film and media, and all of the other departments here at Hunter. We're a growing program. We've been dormant for a few years, but we're definitely in a state of expansion. And if any of you are interested in minoring in Asian American Studies, if you are currently taking Asian American Studies courses and you want to talk more about them, feel free to come see me. We have moved, and we're on the 10th floor of Hunter East in 1037 Hunter East, which is across the hallway from the Sikh program, essentially. I just want to say a few things about us as well. We will have another program on October 29th, which will be a professional development panel on Asian Americans working in the arts. So we'll have a woman who blogs about race, Carmen Van Kerkho, who's Glenn was on a panel with at Asia Society, actually, and Ken Chen, who's the executive director of the Asian American Writers Workshop, and then two of the editors from Theme magazine will be here as well, and they'll be talking about Asian American representation in the cultural field and also decisions that they made as professionals in terms of entering into that profession. So check out that program, and there'll be more flyers and information about that as the semester goes on. I also just want to thank our co-sponsors, ARI, the Asian American Asian Research Institute, which is located down on 43rd Street, but which is a part of CUNY. Oh yeah, if you can turn off your cell phones, that would be great. It's a part of CUNY, and it's a resource that we all have in terms as undergraduates, graduates, and faculty. And so if you're interested in ARI, there are folders down here on the stage, and I'll pass some of those around. I also have folders about the Asian American Studies program here. I also want to thank Asia, Asian Students in Action. I don't know if there are any Asia members here, but they're co-sponsors. I saw some glances. And then also the Office of the Dean of Arts and Sciences, who generously made it possible for us to be in this room. Because as you know, you have to pay to use space at Hunter. Lastly, I will be passing around a sign-up sheet. If any of you are interested in learning more about Asian American Studies, you can put down your name and email address here. And I promise I won't harass you too much. So, I am very excited about today's program. Glenn just did a presentation in my Asian 210 class, which was fantastic, and I'm sure that you've mustered energy to be fantastic again, hopefully. To my knowledge, we are the first academic program at Hunter to do anything explicitly in relation to this upcoming election, and I'm very proud of that. I'm very proud to have Glenn here, and I'm very grateful that Glenn is here because he is volunteering his time to do this program with us. I feel like you're more adept at introducing yourself than I may be, but I just want to say that that when I first met Glenn at the Asia Society presentation, it was clear to me that he could very clearly and with a great deal of inspiration talk about questions that relate to all of us, specifically in relation to this election, but also just in terms of the need to participate in elections and in community advocacy in the city and in this country. And it's something that comes up a lot in my classes because many students feel disenfranchised or they feel that their vote or their actions don't actually matter. And in many ways, when I saw Glenn's presentation, he disputes that assumption and that what we do and what we say and how we vote and our sense of feeling entitled to have a say really does matter. So, thank you, Glenn, for coming, and let's just give him a warm welcome.
So exciting. It's always great to be back at Hunter. I actually used to teach upstairs in urban studies. I taught one of the graduate programs in urban affairs and voting rights, and I also teach at Rutgers Law School. I teach race in the law, that talked about the history of race and racism, both in the United States and also remedies. How do we as lawyers and as American citizens fight against the history of discrimination and bias in the United States today? And one of the things that I was thinking about after Professor Hayes's class is, those of you who are maybe interested in practicing law or being lawyers, if any of you is interested in doing law school, I'm also happy to talk about some of that. I will obviously talk about substantively what is going to happen in these upcoming elections, what is the impact that our community has in these elections. And it's an incredibly exciting time. But I also want to take a little bit of my own personal time to talk about your experience, to hear about your experiences and your interests in what you want to do professionally, what you want to do after Hunter, what you want to do after this journey here. And there's a number of things that can happen. Law school is one opportunity and things that you can do, but there are so many other careers. So to the extent that anyone's interested in talking about careers in the law, as a professor of law, I'm happy to talk with you about it. But we're here to talk about the elections and Asian American, the vote. I want to give a little bit of a background of Asian American voting, a little bit of ALDEF and the work that we do. ALDEF is a national organization founded in 1974. We protect and promote the legal rights of Asian Americans through litigation, legal advocacy, and community education. We have a number of program areas around immigrants' rights, hate crimes, workers' rights, language rights, educational equity. Part of the work that we do is we want to make sure that the laws of the United States, whether they are on immigration, whether they're in voting, whether they're in labor, fully apply to our community. And as lawyers, there's three different things that we do. One, we are enforcing the law. So for example, one of the things that I do is, in our voting rights program, we want to make sure that these provisions of law, the Constitution of the United States, which says that under the 14th Amendment, the 15th Amendment, and the Voting Rights Act, that people have a right to vote, are fully applied. Sometimes, so we do enforcement. Sometimes we are striking down laws. In language, in vote immigrants' rights, there's a number of problems that is actually occurring in the arena. Actually, do I have that slide? Yes, I do. Crawford versus Indiana is a lawsuit that we filed against the state of Indiana for discriminatory identification requirements that was applied to first-time voters. The second thing that we do is we strike down laws. As a lawyer, we go into court and say that the jurisdiction, that the city, that the Congress is acting unconstitutionally and repugnant to the Constitution of the United States. And remember, this is a bill. Oh, no, that's the wrong cartoon. Remember Marbury versus Madison, that courts define the law and they can declare them unconstitutional. So sometimes we are enforcing the law, as I do in Chinatown versus Voter Education Alliance versus Ravitz, making sure that Section 203, that the Voting Rights Act, fully applies for Asian Americans and that we have fully translated ballots in New York. We are striking down laws, like in Crawford versus Indiana, where there are discriminatory identification checks that are happening. Or sometimes we are making new laws, where we are lobbying Congress to have favorable immigration policies or changing something. And that is the work that we do as lawyers. And I want to talk a little bit more about that. But going back, these are the jurisdictions in the United States with the largest Asian American populations. New York, Texas, Illinois, some of these jurisdictions here. One of the things that we know, and let me explain, this is so big. I feel like Al Gore. Do you remember that? So this is like an inconvenient truth, or an Asian American truth, right? So if I had to stand, I would just go up. So back up there is, this is enormous, here, clicker. Can you see that? So Asian CVAP, citizen voting age population. Those are the Asian American populations. These are the jurisdictions with the nation's largest Asian American populations. So after that, you have percent registered, the numbers of Asian Americans who are registered to vote, and then percent voted is of those who are registered. Now, the thing to learn about here, and I also included Connecticut since we're in the Northeast, with the states with the largest Asian American populations, is that the Asian American registration numbers, they're what, in the 40s, 50s, maybe 60s? They're fairly low. Asian Americans have very low voter registration rates. However, the real story is in percent voted. Those numbers are in the 70s, 80s, actually even 90s. Asian Americans have some of the highest voter turnout rates, and these numbers actually rival every demographic of whites, African Americans, Latinos actually are comparable with whites. The story for Asian American voters in the upcoming election is that we turn out to vote once we are registered. The problem is that a lot of us aren't registered. And the question is, why is that, and how do we counter that? How do we make sure that our community, in these very important and historic elections, will have a full and fair say in the outcome, in the election and in the electoral process? All that I talked about, the voting rights litigations where we enforce the law, we have ongoing investigations to deal with the growing Asian American community. Here in New York, we've had a Chinatown for decades, centuries. Actually, one of the professors upstairs will talk about how it's been here for over a century, right? But we have new Asian American populations in other parts of the United States. Philadelphia's Chinatown, Boston's Chinatown, where I have a lawsuit. We want to make sure that there are other areas in which we can fully enfranchise minority voters in the political process. We do legal advocacy on behalf of Asian American voters for bilingual ballots and for interpreters. And then we will run a national election protection program. One of the things that I'll do after this program is I'm going to talk about Asian American voting patterns, but we will run an election protection program in a number of jurisdictions across this country. We want to make sure that the vote that we try to cast on election day is fully operative, that discrimination and bias does not occur at the poll sites. And actually, afterwards, there's a sign-up sheet that is available. Actually, let me introduce, this is Allison Wade. Allison's one of our student interns here this semester, and there's actually a sign-up sheet that'll go around if you're interested in helping us on election day. And we'll be monitoring the elections for compliance with the Voting Rights Act, for the Help America Vote Act, and we'll also be conducting a multilingual exit poll. One of the problems that happens after Election Day is that the media, the New York Times, USA Today, CNN, will report out on the vote. And they'll report it out for different groups, for different races. Bush versus Gore, Bush versus McCain, Bush versus Gore, Bush versus Kerry, Obama versus Hillary Clinton, Huckabee versus McCain. They'll report out different groups. They'll report it out total vote, then gender. Are women voting a certain way? Age, how do young people vote versus older people? And racial groups, whites, African Americans, Latinos, and other. And Asian Americans are excluded from that process. All that runs a national multilingual exit poll to try to tease out a little bit more Asian American voting patterns in the upcoming elections. And I want to talk about some of those findings. These are the jurisdictions that we covered. You know them, New York, New Jersey, Massachusetts, Michigan, Illinois. Please note that Michigan, Virginia, and Pennsylvania are some of our key states. Those are the swing states. Those are the states where we believe, and in a couple of others, where we believe they will carry the elections, because there's a fair number of Democrats and Republicans. These are states which are in the top 10 of having the nation's largest Asian American population. There is an incredible impact that Asian Americans can have in the upcoming election, if we fully exercise the right to vote, and if those votes actually get counted. And that's not necessarily assured, and I'll talk about that later on in the presentation. So we surveyed 4,000, almost 5,000 Asian American voters, mostly Chinese, followed by South Asians, Korean, Southeast Asians. 17% are born in the United States, 83% are foreign born. And this is the story, right? 82% are foreign born. Our community comes to the political process at a very different place. Where is it that we learn about, and what we know about Asian American voters, where is it that we learn about the three-ring circus? The executive, the legislature, the judiciary, right? Congress, the governor, the presidency. We learn that in American schools, in high school, in grammar school, in colleges, in the United States. You don't necessarily learn that in Bombay or Taiwan or Beijing, right? And so for Asian Americans, we come from a much more basic place where some of us come from countries which lack a history of voting. Some of us come from countries where if you vote the wrong way, the government will exterminate you. And so in our democracy, we find that we need to do a lot more basic education around Asian, about the importance of participating in the elections. The other story that's here is that 29% of Asian American voters have no formal U.S. education. Now, for all the talk of Asian Americans being an advanced, a highly educated group, there's some truth to that. A third, 36% have a college degree, one in five have an advanced degree. But one third of us have no formal U.S. education. It's the model minority myth, right? And so if they have no formal U.S. education, again, there's a process that needs to be undergone on what it is that Asian Americans need to know to understand the American political process. In 2006, Asian Americans were voting at the first time 6 times higher than the national electorate. 2% were voting for the first time. For Asian Americans, it was 13%. And party enrollment, most Asian Americans we find enroll in the Democratic Party. Now, what's interesting in studying the Asian American vote over the years is that, well, let me do this graph first, that most Asian Americans in the Midwest and the East Coast enroll in the Democratic Party. South Asians are the most loyal Democrats. South Asians, mostly Vietnamese, and also Filipinos, tend to be a little bit more Republican. Chinese, a large number, a plurality, are actually not enrolled in any political party. But one of the things that I found in studying the Asian American vote for the past 11 years, I started this work in the 90s, is that Asian Americans are not necessarily beholden to a political party. Asian Americans in one of the former gubernatorial mayoral races in New York voted for Mayor Giuliani, who is a Republican. And they also voted for Bloomberg, who was then a Republican, but they also voted for Senator D'Amato, a Democrat. And so politicians and the parties always wonder, are Asian Americans a Democratic or Republican base? We know, like African Americans, much, much more Democratic and a reliable Democratic voting bloc. For Asian Americans, even though most of us enroll in the Democratic Party, there are still questions of loyalty. And Asian Americans tend to take a little bit more of a closer look at our candidates and try to figure out whether they are the best candidates who represent our interests. And it's an interesting story because I'm always asked, are Asian Americans going to vote for Obama in this election? And I said, I don't know. And I say that because has Obama made the case for being the best president who will represent the interests of Asian American voters? Likewise, has McCain necessarily made his case of why he is best represented? I mean, some people think, okay, he was in Vietnam, right, in a camp, maybe he knows the community, which is kind of off base, but you know, for some people that means something, I don't know what, but it is. But that is the question, is that, you know, the candidates are doing what they're doing, they're campaigning, that's fine, but I still think when we look at the issues that matter, civil rights, immigration, healthcare, education, there may be clear differences between the candidates, but those issues need to be found and be made more real in the community. And I'll talk about some of those issues about why that happens. What we do know in 2006, the nation voted for change, and the nation delivered the Congress to the Democratic Party. Asian Americans also voted for change in 2006, and they voted for the Democratic candidates. And these are some of those key races that we had pulled, Virginia, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and New Jersey. Virginia is often credited with being the state that delivered the Congress to the Democrats. That vote was decided by 2 percentage points. The Asian American vote in Virginia was 2 percentage points. And 76% of Asian Americans voted for Mr. Webb. Many political pundits, in fact, there's another program happening very soon that will talk about how that was the case that actually made it happen. But I want to also talk about a couple of other things that have happened in the media. Time magazine, if any of you were following the primary elections March and April, Time magazine wrote an article, "Does Obama Have an Asian Problem?" It was a very interesting article. And it talked about whether Asian Americans would vote for Mr. Obama. Would Asian Americans vote for a black man? It's fascinating to me because it actually was one of the first articles that looked at race. And I do think that the conversation, particularly in this election, we need to talk about gender and we need to talk about race because that will be front and center. But race is not only the African American experience, it is also the Asian American experience. And people had asked if Asian Americans would vote for Obama. And like I said, I mean, I don't know. What I do know is from polling Asian Americans is that we find cross-racial solidarity. Mr. Menendez in New Jersey is Latino, and we found that a majority of Asian Americans voted for him. And in Massachusetts, Deval Patrick, former Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights, is African-American. A black man ran for governor in Massachusetts and won, and Asian-Americans voted for him. So what we know is that Asian-Americans will vote for candidates of their choice. We find that in the political context, there is cross-racial solidarity. Solidarity between Asians and Latinos, between Asians and African-Americans. So they would vote for Obama, but the question is, has Obama made the case? They may also vote for Mr. McCain. Has Mr. McCain made the case for why Asian Americans need to vote for him? And those are the questions that will come out. I haven't seen a lot of polling done that looks at the Asian American vote. There's a lot of polling that's done looking at African Americans, looking at Latinos, but Asian Americans tend to be that group that's like other, right? That we don't matter. It's unimportant. And the work that I do is about bringing Asian Americans to the fore. Is about expanding the work and the voice of Asian Americans in the political process. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so happy to be here. Asian Americans also have very serious opinions on the issues that matter for our community. Around immigration, Asian Americans in 2006 overwhelmingly demonstrated strong support for favorable immigration policies. I also have this broken out by different Asian ethnic groups, South Asian, Chinese, Korean, and I also have it broken out by Asian Republicans and Asian Democrats. One of the things that, it's not this slide, but we do have, is that we find Asian American Republicans, as well as Asian American Democrats, also favor immigration policy. Now, what I did a year ago, and I continued to do earlier this year, is that we actually went to Congress. I was on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., and I actually did a briefing for the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus and staff members on Capitol Hill around this. This is the vote. Asian Americans voted for these clowns for office. These are the issues. Asian Americans believe in immigration reform. It would seem to me that if Asian Americans believe in this, and they voted for these clowns for office, that these clowns should support these issues when they get to Washington, D.C. That is still the struggle that needs to happen. But those are the stories that we are trying to push for. If our community voted as a bloc and essentially put someone to office, if our community said that you need to represent our issues, that these are the issues that matter and they need to be brought to the fore in the upcoming election. And that is the work that we continue to do. What I say as a voting rights lawyer is that political process and the enfranchisement of all citizens, regardless of immigration, race, class, gender, sexual orientation, happens and begins with Election Day, but is not only about Election Day. That the struggle for justice and civil rights continues well beyond the elections. That it includes lobbying, it includes signing postcards, obviously it includes registering to vote. But it means speaking out. And what's always interesting to me as an Asian American is that it's really easy for me, especially as a lawyer, to stand up and to speak out. I do that in class, when I was a student, I do that now. But you know, my parents, they're like, why do you do that? This country is so much better than it was like in the homeland. Right? Don't make trouble. Go with the flow. Keep quiet. And so there's always a feeling that we should assimilate, right? And while there may be certain virtues and benefits in going with the flow, there is also certain particular benefits and virtues around speaking up, standing up, and being counted, right? That the issues that matter to us should be brought to the floor. And so the work that we do at ALDEF and in the community is not only about the political enfranchisement of our community, making sure that we can vote and that our votes count, but it's about the long-term political incorporation and engagement of our population to build a government and society which is really fair and equitable for all of us. And these issues that impact not only Asian Americans and immigrants and people with limited English proficiency are very much issues that affect different racial groups, African Americans, Latinos, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender communities, women, there's a number of groups where we, uniting and working together on issues, can actually make a tremendous amount of difference. Immigration and immigration policy in the United States are one of those key issues that we need to work together on and work on. Asian Americans also encountered in 2006 a number of barriers in their own lives because of the immigration battles that were happening in 2006. And this is 2 years ago. We asked if you or your family had ever been affected by anti-immigrant sentiment. 30%, a third of Asian American voters, said yes, that they are 47% in public locations. The worst in situations were in Virginia and was in Michigan. And what's particularly interesting here is that this is a survey of voters. And what are voters? Voters are citizens of the United States. Voters are not immigrants, but yet they also face anti-immigrant sentiment. And that is the message that we are trying to put out there, is that how these issues need to be brought to the fore, and we have to raise these in the political context. The other thing that we look at is limited English proficiency, access to the vote. Do Asian Americans have the ability to fully exercise their right to vote? One of the things that I do is actually enforcement of the Federal Voting Rights Act to make sure that bilingual ballots and language materials are actually available. Things like this. Voting, if you've ever voted before, can you see that? Yeah, you can. Oh, here you go, it's lit up. Right, signs like this. Vote here in English, Chinese, and Spanish, and Korean. Is it available? Is it hung like this? Is it not there and it's entirely missing? Signs like this did not happen because the Board of Elections in New York City said, oh, we want to help people, right? There's a lot of Latinos, and we need to enfranchise them now. It happened because of political struggle. It happened because Latinos many years ago said, a couple of decades said, you know, many of us don't speak English and we want to be able to vote and we need assistance to be able to do that. It is the same struggle that residents of Chinatown took in the late 80s to say that we need bilingual ballots, and the same work that Koreans did in Queens around language assistance for Korean American voters. The law is about making sure that language assistance, when so many of us are limited English proficient, can fully exercise our right to vote. But we still find that there are problems in when these materials are available at poll sites. We do poll monitoring in a number of jurisdictions. And in New York, I talked about how ballots were mistranslated in one election in 2000. Translated ballots were mistranslated, wherein they flipped the party headings, and Democrats were listed as Republicans. Republicans were listed as Democrats in Chinese. Poll workers said, oh, it's not a problem, they should learn English. In San Francisco, Asian American voters were turned away from voting because there were not enough interpreters to assist them. They can come back later. And in Los Angeles, like I talked about here, translated voting materials were hung upside down or unavailable to voters. The Federal Voting Rights Act requires that jurisdictions with large numbers of Asian Americans must provide interpreters and language assistants and translated ballots for voters. But my job as a lawyer, and the work that a number of people that we'll be working with on Election Day, is to make sure that these materials are fully operative after Election Day. Source of news. Now, this is the issue that we wanted to look at, particularly in looking at the campaigns Obama and McCain. In 2004, we found that a large number of Asian American voters got their news about politics and community events from the Asian language media. 46% got it from the English language media. 36%, one-third, got their news about ethnic media in Asian languages. One of the things that was really interesting to me is I went to the Board of Elections in Queens one time, and one poll worker said to me, well, if they don't speak English, how do they know what's going on? How can they understand politics? And I said, well, there are newspapers. It's fascinating to me how people have this concept that if you don't speak English, that you're stupid, that you don't know how the world works. But yet there's this concept that you don't know. And yet so many of us actually get our news from the Asian language media, from Tsinghua World Journal. They don't necessarily read the New York Times. And so this is where, if so many Asian Americans are getting their news from the Asian language media, and that's where the question becomes, is that where the candidates are necessarily campaigning? The media will definitely report out on tonight's debate and the prior debates and the upcoming debates, and we'll talk about new developments. The question is, are the candidates actually reaching out to the community? Are they taking ads out in Tsingtao, World Journal, the Korea Press, or Tikana? That is yet to be seen. Some of the bigger publications like El Diario, Ehoy, the Latino, the Spanish language press, they are. The Asian language media, they could be doing a better job. And I do this all the time, right? I constantly beat up on Democrats and Republicans, on the RNC and the DNC, because it's about representing issues that matter for our community. They may be fine, but the question is, what are they doing for these issues? And that's important. And of course, we looked at different demographic groups and Chinese, South Asian, Koreans, and which ones are using media. Obviously, Chinese and Koreans, highest rates of Asian media in ethnic languages. Filipino and South Asians are reading mostly media, still the ethnic media, but also in English. And voting problems. Like other minority voters in Florida, Asian Americans encountered a whole host of barriers to exercise their right to vote. Like voters in Florida who came to vote and their names were missing from lists, they were turned away. The United States Supreme Court, in the historic lawsuit in 2004, the historic lawsuit of 2000, oh my God, it was so long ago, in Bush versus Gore, said that if you have lost your right to vote on election day, you have lost your right to vote forever. We almost never redo an election, and certainly not an election for president. And so what we find, though, is that Asian Americans still encountered problems in accessing their right to vote. And those problems that happened in Florida in 2000, and I guess in Ohio in 2004, will happen again. Asian Americans were racially profiled and required to produce identification checks. In Floral Park, Queens, we had one South Asian American voter who was racially profiled and was required to bring his naturalization certificate. No other voter was required to bring their naturalization. How many of you have your naturalization certificates in this room? Great, because you can't get into Hunter College, a government building. Did you bring your naturalization certificate? No. Oh, well, maybe you did. I don't know. But that's what this voter had to do. And so we are concerned about discriminatory application. I had a voter in Boston, Massachusetts, who was told that his identification was not good enough. He had a United States passport. Now, usually, a U.S. passport is the best form of identification. Poll workers said, oh, it's not good enough. It needs, you know, it needs an address. And that's a problem. We found that Asian American voters encountered discourteous and hostile poll workers. What's fascinating to me is that American democracy, American society, that the demographics of our country have changed tremendously since 1934. But poll workers have not. That there is still a demographic group, little old white ladies who work at most poll sites, who administer the vote. And they're very nice, you know? But they don't necessarily know the new differences of our community and what has changed in those communities. And so when that happens, you see now where they say, oh, we have to protect the vote from these foreign voters. If they don't speak English, how do we know that they're a citizen? And a lot of these very old-time prejudices, prejudices that were harbored by people many, many years ago, really come out today in the elections. And that interferes with Asian Americans being able to exercise the right to vote. So many times I've seen the story of the little old Korean grandmother who struggles with her walker in Flushing, Queens, the PS20, and she will decide the next governor of New York or mayor of New York City or president. And she gets to the front of the line, and she's treated with discourtesy, hostility, and problems. As Asian Americans, we're taught to respect our elders. They're the ones who worked hard for us. They're the ones who worked hard for our parents to put us through school, to put food on our plate. And yet, when they come to vote, because of how they look, because of what they wear, because of how they smell, because of their eyes or their language, they're treated like children. They're treated, they're spoken loudly at, discriminated against, and there's a problem with that. The work that we do on election day is try to guard against some of this discriminatory treatment. We also find that voters are directed to the wrong poll site or precinct, that their names are missing from lists. Voters named Sin Yang Ling becomes Ling Sin Yang. A voter who's Korean and his name is Yeon Jae Kim, Go Sin, and poll worker says, oh, there's a mistake. It's not Yeonjae Kim. Kim, Kimberly, that's the first name. I'll fix it, right? And then it's Kimberly Yeonjae, and that person doesn't exist, and that she's been he's been genderized to be something else, and then he comes to vote and he's not there, right? And so there are all these little problems that have this effect of disenfranchising voters from being able to exercise their right to vote on election day. So on election day, we have a national program where we're working with pro bono attorneys, we're working with volunteer law students, and we will be working with college students across the campuses. I'm actually giving this talk at South Texas Law School, a week from tomorrow. So I'll be in Texas, I'll be up in Boston next Thursday, I'll be at American University on Monday to talk about the Asian American vote and the ability to protect our community's right to vote. So, this is a sign-up form. If you are able to help us on election day, we are asking for people with bilingual ability or the opportunity to do something on election day who can protect our community's right to vote. It is a one-hour training, and we will train you on the Federal Voting Rights Act, on the Help America Vote Act. We will go over the problems and issues that affect Asian American communities on election day. And then we will put you out into the field on election day, November 4th, 2008, for at least 3 hours, 6 hours, 9 hours. Some of you, our interns and volunteers, will be working all, and staff will be working all day to protect our community in their ability to vote. Some of the forms are green, some of them are orange. It's still the same form, they're just like different trainings. We will put you out into the field on election day for 3 hours to conduct a survey, to look at Asian American voting patterns, to look out for discrimination, bias, and harassment. In many ways, on election day, you will be our community's first line of defense. In 2000, after the elections had all these problems, we ran to Florida afterwards. We want to make sure that in 2008, we are prepared for those problems. We will assign attorneys and law students and undergraduate students to these jurisdictions to make sure that there are interpreters, that the right to vote is not frustrated, that our grandparents, that our aunties and uncles are treated with dignity and respect that they are entitled to, and that if they cast a provisional ballot, that those ballots will actually get counted after election. But we need your help. We need your help in these jurisdictions in New York City and any other jurisdictions that you want to work in. So if you have 1 hour for training, and if you are taking an Asian American Studies class here, I believe most of them, we will be doing a training for you, and we'll go over what to do on election day and what the issues are. 3 hours or all day on election day, and then about an hour in reporting afterwards. And the hour in reporting afterwards is really to find out what happened on election day. One of the observations that was made after the 2004 elections in Boston, Massachusetts, is a student at Northeastern University, you know, one of our volunteers, he's going to his poll site and he's going to conduct a survey. He thinks it's pretty cool. He's going to get some extra credit for his class. He thought it was good. And he goes in and he sees one voting booth and two lines. All the Asians are on one line and all the white voters are on another line. He's like, what's going on? Why are there two lines that is clearly delineated by race? Poll worker said, we thought it would make the vote go, we wanted to hurry people up. We thought it would make the line go faster. But who do you think got to vote first and who had to wait at the back of the bus? I mean, who had to wait after everybody else was done? We have not seen segregated voting lines or segregated drinking fountains, colored people and white people, since the 1930s and 40s in Alabama and Mississippi or Georgia. But we saw them in Boston, Massachusetts in 2004. And that student at Northeastern it was the witness to discriminatory conduct, wherein we found discriminatory conduct that was used as a key piece of our litigation against the city of Boston, and it was relied on by the observations of a student. And because of that litigation, Boston, Massachusetts now has fully translated ballots in Chinese and Vietnamese in that jurisdiction because of the growing Asian American community. We are very proud of that work. But we still find that there are growing Asian American communities, Gujarati speakers in Central Jersey, Koreans in New Jersey, Punjabi speakers in Richmond Hill, growing Asian American communities in a number of areas in New York City. But we want to make sure that their vote counts, that they are not discriminated against in the political process, and that we have a say. So if you have a couple of hours to help us on Election Day, poll sites are open from 6 a.m. in the morning to 9 p.m. You can help us out before class or after class. It might be part of your class. Please sign up. Allison is here. She'll take some of the forms when you're done. And with that, I just want to recognize that there's a number of co-sponsors that we work with across the United States. Bar associations, community organizations, national community-based groups. We can't do it without them. And with that, thank you very much, and I'll take some questions. Questions?
I had a quick question on the numbers. Were those, on the voting patterns of Asian Americans, were those national or local?
They were multi-state, mostly East Coast and the Midwest. So they covered the jurisdictions, these states.
Okay.
The one state that's missing is California. We actually have affiliates in California, in LA and San Francisco. They actually do their own exit poll, and so we put some of that data together. When we're in Washington, D.C., nationally we do that. Here I try to focus on the Midwest and the East Coast. New York, New Jersey, Chicago, Connecticut, Pennsylvania. Other questions? Sir?
You mentioned how the Korean guy named Kim was entered at Kimberly and and whatnot, that kind of examples. How often are they desperate, deliberate disenfranchisement, and how often are they just pure ignorance?
I don't know. And then I do know. Let me give you a couple of examples, and then you could tell me what you think. So obviously, you have the situation where you have a well-meaning poll worker who wants to fix a mistaken voter registration form. Mr. Yeonjae Kim doesn't know that he's a woman and that his first name is Kimberly. So the poll worker intentionally, but with good intention, wants to help and fix it for Mr. Kimberly Yeonjae. So that's one situation. Sinyan Ling becomes Ling Sinyan. But then there are also situations where it is voter lives at 149 East 48th Street becomes 149 West 48th Street. Voter lives in apartment 4D becomes voter who lives at apartment 4B. Human error and technological problems, which are purely just based on anything on incompetency, is maybe defensible. But then what we find is that voters with foreign names, and it's not just Asian names, like the Korean names and traditional Chinese names, but also Muhammad, Rodriguez, right, with a Z, R, or S, Muhammad with an A, U, or O, or Arabic names with a hyphen or hyphenated names, are they treated in a different way from names like Jones, Smith, Mary? And then there is a question of, are poll workers entering names intentionally to disenfranchise people? I'm not sure. But does it happen with a higher preponderance with those names that are not traditional English names from England? I think so. And therein lies a problem, that there may not be the intent to discriminate intentionally, but in the treatment of people, you have therefore discriminated because it's only those foreign names, right? Those peculiar names that are listed and not the other names. And that's where the problem is. The reason why I'm being a little cagey in responding to it, because that's a question that a judge will ask me. And that's a hard thing to prove. Are you intentionally disenfranchising minority voters? Are you intentionally trying to suppress their vote? I'm not sure that that actually applies as much for Asians as it does for African Americans. But have you treated them in a way that doesn't matter, that with carelessness, you don't pay attention to a form that's translated to Chinese as well as an English form, and then you have discriminatory treatment? And I would argue, and I do argue, that that is still illegal and unconstitutional. But that's a question that a judge needs to make. So it's a case that we're still working on and that we're trying to develop, and the work that if you help us on election day, we'll be trying to gather some of these facts to uncover, is this racially discriminatory treatment, and is there a legal remedy to do some of this work? Other questions? Ma'am.
How are poll workers chosen or trained? I mean, is there anyone who supervises them?
Yes. There are poll workers. Most poll workers are appointed by the Democratic and Republican Party. So local district leaders, Democratic Republican district leaders, submit a name for people to be poll workers at particular poll sites. Interpreters who speak Chinese, Korean, or Spanish do not have to be appointed by the political party. Poll workers who are appointed by the political party must also be in registered voters and enrolled in that political party. So you see a system of patronage, right? If you're already a Democrat, you can be a Democratic poll worker. But if you're not enrolled and you want to get involved, you generally can't do that, but you can be an interpreter. So the parties generally appoint interpreter poll workers. There's two at each election district, there's two and two. Two Republicans, two Democrats. And the theory in New York is that we cheat. The people cheat in elections. But if you have two Democrats and Republicans, they'll both want to cheat and they'll counter each other, so nobody will cheat. It's actually quite interesting. But it's premised on the belief that there's cheating and the cheaters will counteract each other and that'll be fine. And I actually think it works because they actually do watch each other, look out for each other. The supervision that's provided on election day is that there is a poll site coordinator, one or two people who have to supervise anywhere from 12 to 40 poll workers, depending on the poll site. And you can imagine how those larger poll sites are much, much more difficult to supervise. All poll workers go through at least a 3-hour training by the Board of Elections. Some of it goes through 6 hours. And if you ever sit through any of them, it's quite challenging. They're boring. I mean, it's like this person is like, she's just like reading a manual and she's going word for word on exactly what you need to do. She doesn't even make eye contact. And so it's not really a very sophisticated program, but they get a manual, they get trained, they're supposedly trained on this law. And hopefully and usually they do administer the elections in conformance with the law. But those are some of the issues that we need to deal with. Other questions?
Could you talk a little bit about the Asian American youth vote? Because I have a lot of students who talk a lot about voting differently from their parents and how that breaks down, either intuitively or through.
What does that mean? I mean, I want to throw that out because I've actually heard that a couple of times. How many people feel that they're voting differently from their parents? Oh, are you not to necessarily discourage the private vote? And how are your parents voting and how are. Oh, is that fair to ask? If you want to say it, you don't have to, but how your parents are voting and how you're voting. Parents, how do they generally vote? Sure.
My parents vote.
Who else? And is that true for this upcoming election?
Yeah.
No, and I'm serious. Because I think that there are some people who historically and in the past, parents who voted more Republican, but in this election may be willing to flip the part, may be willing to vote for the Democratic candidate. Other people, who's the parents? Did I see other hands? I think that's interesting. I think that's interesting because what we find is, in studying Asian American voting patterns, actually, do I have that slide? Oh, I don't have it. I think that's right. I think older generations tend to be a little bit more conservative, and younger generations tend to be a little bit more liberal. The problem that I find, though, not the problem, the issue that I have observed in looking at Asian American voting patterns by age groups is that it's actually senior Asian Americans over 50 that have the highest political participation rates. And it's Asian American young people under 30, 18 to 29, that actually have the lowest political participation rates. Now that smacks directly against what the political pundits have said that has happened in this past election, that Obama is becoming the Democratic candidate because young people, student voters, are the new generation. There's a tremendous amount of outreach. What I'm observing actually in the field is that, well, there's a lot of work that's happening on college campuses, particularly four-year colleges, the dormitory schools, the private universities. But I'm not finding the same sort of vigor happening at the community colleges, where there are poor young people who actually have to work that are not able to go to school. And I actually find that young people, and there's studies that actually show that young Asian Americans, particularly under 29, particularly who come from families where their parents are foreign born, and are not citizens, but they are a citizen, and their household lacks a history of voting, they do not participate in the elections. And there's a whole cadre of people that hang out at the clubs in lower, I mean, you do voter register, you try to go to a club, my interns used to do this, where they go to a nightclub and ask them how many people are registered to vote. And at these Asian American clubs, I don't know, like Club Asia or whatever they're called. Do you know what I'm talking about? You don't know at all. Is this not what you all do anymore? Okay, so back in my day, I understood that there were these like nightclubs that like kids used to go to clubs at all the time, and like there were all these Asian people there. And you know, it's like where you meet people. And the rates of voter participation and being registered was very low. And it was interesting to me because the only people that was participating from our community tended to be older Asian Americans, which on one level is like a good thing, but if young people aren't participating in the elections and young people are supposed to be our future, what does that mean? I mean, that's the reason why we get written off, why Asian Americans are that other category or Asian Americans don't matter. It's why programs like Asian American Studies are actually underfunded or not funded or don't exist at college campuses and they do at other schools. Is the ability to speak out and the desire to fund these programs because it is our community that wants to learn about those issues. So that's sort of like my thinking, but I do think that there is a generational divide, a clear generational divide in looking at Asian American voting patterns, particularly by age. Sir?
Don't you think this trend just coincides with the national trend, just all the national, all the generation, no matter if it's Asian or not? No matter if white or color, the young generation really tends to not vote.
Yes. Wait. Tends to not vote or be more democratic.
I mean, they usually don't have that kind of opinion, or they're having difficulty of choosing one over the other.
No. Yes, in that Asian young people tend to be more liberal than older people. So that does follow the national trend and other demographic groups, but no in far as young people have lower political participation. The National Association of Secretary of State actually came out with a study that actually looked at demographic patterns of voting patterns of young people, and they actually are one of the few groups that actually compared the different racial groups, Asian Americans, Latinos, African Americans, Native Americans, and found Black voters, white voters, Black young people, white young people had extremely high rates of political participation. Young Asian Americans actually really didn't. And it's all for, it's US-born voters. You could look it up in their site, but it was pretty, it was surprising to me. Or confirm some of the observations that I had had. You had a question, ma'am.
Just if you had some comment about, candidates for office, because people also come out and vote when there's someone that sort of looks like you, knows your issues, talks to your issues. Because we don't have a whole lot of elected officials
from the Asian community. That's right. I used to give this talk before John Liu and Ellen Young and now Grace Meng were elected, the first Asian American city councilman, the first Asian American elected officials in the state legislature. Jimmy Meng too was there. I used to give this talk 10 years ago, how New York City has the nation's largest Asian American population, and we've never seen an Asian American elected city council, state legislature, or Congress. I can't say that anymore. Now I can say, New York City has one of the largest Asian American populations in the country, and we only have one Asian American elected to city council and to state legislature, and no one to Congress. The representation of Asian Americans is still woefully disjointed and not representative of either the demographics of the Asian American community or proportionate to the size of us in the population. Asian Americans are 10% of New York's population, and yet we have 1 in 52 city council members. We have 1 out of 120 state assembly members, and we have 0 out of 1 in 30 members of Congress. Plus, all those represented leaders are Chinese. And not that I don't love Chinese people, but there's a lot of Koreans, there's a lot of Filipinos, Indians, Bangladeshis, Pakistani, Guyanese, that's in the community as well. And in fairly large numbers, right? I'm not talking about the very few small numbers, but Bangladeshis, Koreans are fairly well represented. And I think those communities still struggle for representation. There is something about having a government, legislature, Congress, city council, that represents and looks like the people that it represents. I think it was Thomas Jefferson that said that the legitimacy of the government is vested by the consent and the will of the governed, and that it is because the people say and believe in the government that the government derives its power. But what if that government doesn't look like us? What if it's a whole bunch of white men and the community is mostly communities of color, and half of them are women? The next question, and the more advanced question, is, well, what if you do have elected leadership that represents the polity, but they're not necessarily friendly to communities of color, or they're hostile to communities of color? The clear example is Justice Thomas, African-American member of the United States Supreme Court. He ain't very good on a lot of the issues that the black community has identified are important to African-Americans, and yet he's black. I mean, I know Justice Thomas, we've talked about this before. and it's actually a very interesting conversation with him. But anyway, is it about having someone who looks like me in the government? There's an incredible amount of value and importance in that. But is it also about having a government that works on the issues that I'm concerned about? Immigration, healthcare, economy, jobs, whatever those issues might be. And those things can be in tension. And that's actually where I think, in some ways, the Democrats and communities of color don't necessarily have, excuse me, I think in some way, that's where Democrats and voters of color have had a little bit of attention. African Americans argue, you know, have we been taken advantage of by the Democratic Party, right? Why do we have a say? But then do you go to the Republican Party? Is the Republican Party a better party? I don't know. And those are some of the questions that I think we as a community and as a polity are still trying to struggle with. But nevertheless, you never get to that conversation. You cannot just get to that conversation without having an elected leadership that is representative of the people. And ultimately, you have to have that. And that's the excitement over this race. That's the excitement to have a woman on the ballot or to have an African-American man on the ballot. Because Michelle Obama made the statement that I feel like an American. That for the first time in history, we will have somebody in the White House that will represent, that has never been there before. In fact, we will have in the White House somebody who was denied historically the right to vote in this country. Women did not have the right to vote until 1920. Blacks did not have the right to vote until Reconstruction. Somebody will win. And so it's an incredibly historic time for that, but that means, so what does that mean? Is Ms. Palin's positions on consistent and beneficial to women? Maybe, maybe not. I think women would probably say no. However, she's a woman. And for many women, they do want to vote to see, they will vote to make sure that a woman is elected into office. And that's important. And I don't want to take that away from people. Because people do want to say, yes, you want a leader that represents your interests, but you also want a leader that looks like you, that might understand you, that you might be able to reform and educate later on. And sometimes you can do that. I'll make no further comments about that since we have a debate in a few hours. Well, you know. I had to be nonpartisan about it. You know, I could go on all day. No, but I will say, you know, the Democrats and Republicans, I've seen Democrats and Republicans, you know, they can both be very friendly to our community and very hostile. In fact, my experience, which is interesting, is that in Boston, a Democratic mayor, Mayor Menino, I had to fight tooth and nail over my lawsuit for bilingual ballots. And yet in New York, Mayor Bloomberg, who I sued, he's actually settling with a really good settlement decree, and he's a Republican. And so what's fascinating to me is that here I am suing a Democrat and I'm fighting, and I'm suing a Republican and he's friendly. I don't know. Other questions? Here first.
Yeah, just a kind of quick question. In terms of implementation, I'm wondering if states you've dealt with in terms of actual voting systems, be they electronic or otherwise, what sort of differences you see in terms of translation of materials and other, I mean, lawsuits resolution?
We will come back to me on November 5th. There's a lot, that is a whole big issue, and particularly electronic voting machines, particularly with their security and their ability to count votes and whether they can be reprogrammed and hacked, are the issues that will be seen out tremendously after this election. There's a lot of fear and concern about them. Around translated materials, though, they tend to all be equally incompetent, or they tend to all be equally competent in their ability to do it. I mean, an ATM machine is pretty good, but you could mistranslate that too, right? It's a paper ballot that had the Democrats versus Republicans. There's no reason why an ATM machine, which can do that in four languages, make a mistake as well too. So we'll see what happens. Other questions? Yes, ma'am, you had a question.
So I realize that you're trying to you're trying not to lean in one direction or the other. But
very much.
Do you feel that either candidate has made the case
saying that they would align themselves with
the Asian American community and fight for rights over other issues? Yeah, go ahead. Do you want to answer? I have been getting emails from Asians for Obama. So one way of asking, I mean, are there Asians for McCain? I mean, is there, so there is an organization
for
Asians for Obama. You know, is there equivalent? Because it takes organizing for that to happen.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that I actually do think I really cannot get in trouble. I really need to be nonpartisan in this, right? Because I will be complaining about these elections, and so I sort of need to be a little bit pure. But I do want to answer that question. I actually do think that both campaigns have done quite a bit of work to try to reach out to the community. I think Obama has put a little bit more money and resources out to that. I've seen a lot more stuff. I mean, I monitor both parties in political campaigns over it. So I have seen that Mr. Obama's campaign has been a little bit more aggressive in reaching out to Asian Americans. But I also find, and what I was also going through, is that I'm also finding that I'm fighting more with the Obama supporters because there are problems that are happening in the field that they're not paying attention to. And it was interesting because we're fighting over this poll site in Chinatown, in Philadelphia's Chinatown, that was suddenly moved back up. 40 years ago, the way we used to disenfranchise black voters in the United States is they used to move a poll site the night before an election. And so you'd have a whites-only meeting, and then you tell all the white voters, okay, the poll site is no longer school A, it's in school B, so go to school B. And all the white voters would go to school B, and they'd vote. And all the black voters voted at school A before, no election, they can't vote. That is how discrimination happens in the elections, by moving a poll site the week before, the night before an election. Fast forward 40 years to 2008, last week. Philadelphia's Chinatown. Guess what they did? They moved the poll site. And guess what they did? They put signs out. Oh, we told put signs out. What language were they in? English. In where? In Chinatown. They all speak Chinese, so who's gonna know? But the English speakers will know to go to the different poll site. So that's the problem that's happening in Philadelphia, China. They have literally moved the poll site to another location and told people in English where it is, Chinatown. And that's my fight. The Obama supporters are sort of there, oh, that's a problem. I'm like, hello, are you going to say anything? We'll go to the meeting and observe. I'm like, I mean, and they were there during the primary election day. I saw them, you know, we talk. I talked to both political campaigns and both political parties. It's interesting to me that there's a lot of outreach, but as far as correcting problems and making sure that the votes can vote, they're not as interested in that. As long as like the opinions are on their side, election machinery and problems aren't necessarily their interest. And it was fascinating to me, and my realization a week ago is that even this, even if Mr. Obama does come into office, and he may be better on some of these issues, we still need to hold him accountable. Raids and immigration laws will still exist. It's not like he's suddenly going to stop it. In fact, as a nation of laws, not men, the president cannot just suddenly stop everything that happens, that advocacy for healthcare reform, for immigrants' rights, for lower tuition, for fees, lower tuition for financial aid, for all these issues that are very important to many of us, still need to be fought for. And even if Mr. Obama comes in, and even if many people support him, it does not mean he'll be able to get all this stuff in. The Democrats could take over, but that does not mean that it would be a better scenario for all of us in the end. So that's what we certainly need to do. But we will continue to fight, and we will continue to advocate for our community. Other questions? Well, with that, thank you very much. I was very happy to be here. If anyone has any questions about law school or anything, I'll hang out for a little bit. See ya.